If you've ever studied film or advertising, you know that colors are not just randomly chosen. There's a good reason why many personal care products come in white packaging, and that's because white symbolizes purity and cleanliness. If we wanted to note that something is natural, we might use the colors green or brown. Things that are mysterious or wicked might be painted black, while sensuality will almost always come in red. If we're trying to make a scene look happy, we'll use bright colors such as yellow or orange, and if we want something to exude femininity, we might think about using the color pink. While different cultures give different meanings to some colors, the meanings also cross cultures at times. Today, we'll look at mostly one color in this episode of the Infographic Show. Why is blue a boy's color? When we talk about blue and its symbolism, we must first think about what hue of blue we're talking about, because there are many. Crayola, the company that we all know makes crayons, has 19 different blues, but we'll keep this simple and talk about two of the blues you all know well. Those are dark blue and light blue, or sky blue. Dark blue can signify seriousness or even sadness, feeling blue, but also intelligence, integrity, and power. That's why you might find politicians donning a blue suit, rather than, say, a yellow or pink outfit. Light blue is a different animal. It symbolizes purity, tranquility, harmony, and security. But what has any of this to do with boys? Prior to the 19th century, we didn't have a blue for boys and pink for girls binary rule. In fact, most kids just wore white or beige or even rags if you came from the wrong side of the tracks. Historians tell us that it was the mid-19th century that pastel colors became popular. But according to the book Pink and Blue, Telling the Girls from Boys in America, at that time, there wasn't yet a pink and blue rule. It's confusing, though. Listen to what one writer said in the Ladies' Home Journal in 1918. "The generally accepted rule is pink for the boys and blue for the girls. The reason that pink, being a more dedicated and stronger color, is more suitable for the boy, while blue, which is more delicate and dainty, is prettier for the girl." Okay, so what happened? Well, that little snippet didn't mean everyone followed that rule. In fact, one historian tells us that until the 1950s, there was a kind of chaos when it came to colors. You can actually have a look online at something Time magazine published in 1927. It's a chart of sex-appropriate colors. The chart is based on a survey of American clothes stores and what those stores thought was the right color for boys and girls. More stores said pink was the most appropriate color for boys, but not all. According to the writer of that book we mentioned, after World War II, the pink for girls and blue for boys thing started to become popular, but he also says it didn't really stick until the 1980s. This happened during a time when mass marketing was appearing, said one sociologist about this phenomenon. Being gender normal is very important to us, and as a marketing technique, if retailers can convince you that being gender normal means you need to buy a certain product, cosmetics, plastic surgery, blue or pink clothing, etc., it just makes sense from a production or mass marketing perspective, he told Life Science. According to another writer, after the war, people were more than ready for some normalcy in their lives after the utter chaos of global conflict. When labels such as Christian Dior were telling women to don pink, they did so, and they didn't mind doing it. People wanted some stability in their lives, according to that writer at least, and so color gender norms were met with no amount of contempt. Rebellion would come in the 60s, but for a while, women mostly embraced pink and men hugged blue. But why did girls get pink? Well, not everyone says pink is innately feminine. It just became feminine. You see, the French, who were often thought to be the leaders of fashion, used pink as a girl's color. Other countries and cultures didn't, but hey, the French were the avant-garde when it came to clothes, and so some people believe we just followed them. Another sociologist from Italy looked deeper into this blue and pink thing. He used technology to scan books on Google that were published in the USA from 1880 to 1980, and you know what? He could find lots of instances where someone wrote that blue was for boys, but he found no instances of pink being called a boy's color. "Pink seems to have been a feminine color at least since the late 19th century," he said in an interview. And he went as far to say that this thing about a reversal in pink once being a boy's color was probably an urban legend. So now it's confusing. We must ask if indeed it's true that blue is a boy's color and pink is a girl's color. Is there something in our biology that makes it this way? Do boys just like blue more and girls like pink more? Scientists say this just isn't clear. There's no way of proving it, as we can't go back in time. We're already influenced by societal norms. Life Science tells us, "The debate about how exactly we got to the point where something as impartial as the color pink seems infused with femininity will probably rage on in the pages of academic journals. So what we don't know is if girls and boys innately prefer one of the colors. What we do know is that the rule hasn't always been there. But when the rule became clear, companies that made clothes pounced on it, and it has never been reversed. That's not to say boys don't wear pink. They do, but as little children, they are more likely to be dressed in blue than in pink. It gets more interesting, though. Academics tell us that in the 50s and 60s, during a strong movement of feminism, the colors became more unisex again. Many people rebelled against these color norms as they thought they contained inherent gender bias. People didn't want to follow the dogmas of gender norms, and so for a while, blue and pink were again sitting on the fence. In fact, some clothing labels totally dropped the idea of sex-appropriate colors. Feminists argued that the colors in themselves were not innately feminine or masculine, and if you bought into that paradigm of blue for boys and pink for girls, you were conforming to a gender norm that just wasn't true. Girls didn't have to be girly and boys didn't have to be boyish. It was a mixed up, muddled up, shook up world. And the palette was everyone's. We wonder how many of you will get the 60s gender reference in there. But then in the 80s, things changed again. According to one academic, he said that because prenatal testing was developed, parents could go out and buy all their baby stuff before the little parcel of flesh was delivered. Those parents wanted to know what to buy, and manufacturers were more than happy to tell them what to buy. You see, for those in the business of making or selling clothes, having this color binary was a good thing. Why? Because if you bought blue for little Jack, and a year later little Jill springs to life, the parents will have to buy another set of clothes. We're told that the children of the rebels of the 60s were nothing like their parents, and conformity was back in. The 80s were garish and bright, and perhaps fashion has never been more kitschy. Little girls in bright pink was something you'd often see. It was a peculiar decade, perhaps the one decade that people look back on with embarrassment regarding what they wore. Of course, babies wear all kinds of colors, and gender-neutral clothes are in fashion. We know that for a long time, parents have chosen to dress their kids in pastel colors because these colors have a certain innocence and beauty. Imagine if you looked at your baby pictures, and in all of them you were dressed in black, grinning at the camera, with your cute, bright red bonnet on. You might wonder if your parents were trying to cultivate a future Satan slave. So even if you're against blue for boys and pink for girls because it offends your sense of fairness, it's more than likely you'll still adhere to some of the rules. The force is strong with color symbolism. The BBC writes about what it calls the blue and pink gender myth, a myth in that girls and boys are not inherently suited to one color. It's society that manufactures this belief, says the article. Kids in tests before the age of 2, when offered blue or pink object, didn't really have a color preference, but after the age of 2, they conformed to the pink and blue norm. After all, they see that everywhere. In another test, kids aged 3 to 5 were given different colors to wear, and they kind of formed sides. And at the end of a few weeks, the kids just liked their own colors. It didn't matter what it was. Still, this chicken and egg story remains unclear, because scientists still don't really know if there's always been something a little more feminine in the color pink, and that just evolved over time. It might not always be the case, but we must ask how we have ended up with this binary. Did something natural happen that was later pushed by society and manufacturers? Science is still trying to find the answer to this riddle. Some experts tell us women in their research indeed favored bright colors such as red and pink, more than men did. Some of these experts even said that women liked these colors because it was hardwired from our hunter-gatherer days, when men did the hard hunting and women did the gathering of brightly colored berries and such. Maybe that's a stretch, but it's worth considering. Tests have been performed on men and women to see what colors they prefer, and pink is not popular in most of these tests, although women do like pink more than men. More men pick blue than women do, but both sexes seem to like the color. We may not be able to agree on what color should be for what gender, but one thing most people agree on is that Skillshare is the go-to place for improving your existing skills and picking up a whole slew of new ones. Don't like blue for boys and pink for girls? Why not check out one of Skillshare's many arts and crafts or sewing classes and make your own clothes? With over 20,000 classes hosted online, Skillshare is your one-stop shop for learning everything you need to unleash your creative genius. The first 1,000 people to visit the link in the description will receive premium membership for 2 months completely free. Join Skillshare and start learning today.